Hello and welcome everyone to our latest presentation on the role of immunoglobulins in community-acquired pneumonia and COVID-19. So the mortality related with the community-acquired pneumonia remains still quite high in spite of appropriate antibiotics. It is still 11%. And if the antibiotics are not appropriate, it can reach up to 17%. So 1 out of 2 of every 10 patients admitted with a community-acquired pneumonia doesn't survive. Now if we look closely, then as the risk factors increase, the mortality risk also increases. So we need to find the correct target patients who may benefit from immunomodulatory therapies like IVIG. Now, as we all know, there is an immunological dysfunction associated with sepsis. In sepsis, there is low levels of IVIG as all the levels of IgA, IgM and IgG decreases. This results in the poor control of infection and immunopathologies. Now, in specific to community-acquired pneumonia, studies have shown that decreased level of IgG and IgM is associated with increased stay in ICU and mortality in ICU and increased Apache 2 and 28-day mortality. So it means that as the level of immunoglobulins gets lesser in community-acquired pneumonia, the mortality risk increases. Now this is another study which looked into the immunoglobulin concentration and B cell counts in adult community-acquired pneumonia. In this, they divided the patient into mild and severe community-acquired pneumonia, and they found that the people who had a severe disease, they had a decreased level of immunoglobulins. Now serum level of immunoglobulins, and again correlating it with community-acquired pneumonia, here again the low levels of IVIG resulted in a higher risk of mortality. Now, low levels of immunoglobulins are definitely a prognostic factor in the severity of community-acquired pneumonia. Now, severe community-acquired pneumonia admitted to the ICU showed lower levels of circulating immunoglobulins than non-ICU patients. These findings are suggestive that we should continue to investigate the target subgroup in which the of community-acquired pneumonia in which we may find some benefit of giving IVIG therapy and which may result in a reduction in mortality. Now this is a study, observational study on the role of IVIG in the mortality in pneumonia. In this large retrospective national study, they found that there was no significant association with IVIG and mortality in mechanically ventilated pneumonic patients with septic shock. And this is another study. In this, they found that giving the IVIG early had a better outcome than it as it was given late. As the delay was done, the mortality rates increased. Now here is early therapy again, the study published in ICM. In this, they found that the mortality risk in patients who did not receive the IVIG therapy was 46. And in those who did receive, it was 25. So there was a significant mortality benefit in patients who were receiving IgM therapy. Now, if it works, then how it does work? There are some possible mechanisms of this. The first is it has an antibacterial activity. It has an antitoxin activity. It has a cytokine mediator modulation effect. And obviously it has an anti-inflammatory effect as well. Apart from the passive immunization it can produce. So these are the possible mechanisms in which it can act in community-acquired pneumonia and reduce the mortality rates. So as we all are aware, it does have a toxic inactivation activity, but the most important and the most vital, which we are thinking would be of benefit in most patients, is the modulation of the cytokine effects. It definitely does have a good role in the bactericidal action as well. In this, it modulates the release of cytokines and decreasing the pro-inflammatory and increasing the anti-inflammatory mediator, thereby reducing the hyperimmune response, which is resulting in worse outcomes in sepsis associated with community-acquired pneumonia or even COVID-19. Now, here we can see that the molecular immune response in severe community acquired pneumonia, the immune response in non-survivor is always higher than those who have survived. So this is exactly the population we are trying to target. So the best practice is to give it in patients who have a hyperinflammatory response or who have been immunosuppressed to increase the effect of bactericidal and antitoxin effects. So to who to give and when? This is the vital question we have been searching for. Most of the studies are showing that when it is given early, it is shows maximum benefit because it results in pathogen clearance, the toxin scavenging, the mediator scavenging, and the anti-inflammatory effect. So all these effects early on result in significant reduction in the mortality because this is what is leading to the organ failure. And in later stages, it may have some effects, but obviously till now, whatever study has been done, this effect has not been too much. So this is the population which we are targeting. That is to give this drug as early as possible. Now, in this safety and efficacy study of trimodulin, a novel polyclonal antibody in community acquired pneumonia, the Sigma study, in this they had given 23% IgM, 21 IgA and 56% IgG for severe COVID community acquired pneumonia. In this, they found no significant difference in terms of the ventilator free days or mortality. However, if you look closely into the study, then in the subgroup, especially the subgroup which has a hyperimmune response, that is a, noted by a CRP of more than 70 and an IgM of less than 0.8, there is a significant benefit. This significant benefit is something which we can target. So the most important takeaway from this study is that if we target this population, then there is a very high probability that we will get some positive outcome, even though the overall mortality was not very different. But as you target specific population, there is more improvement and more significant benefits seen. Now, if we come back to the COVID-19 situation, there have not been much studies as of now, but the theoretical possibility by which it can give a protective effect in COVID-19 is by inhibition of the neutrophils and the monocytes and by the activation of the phagocytes. All these can result in decreased immune response and better viral clearance. Now, as we all know now that it is the dysregulated immune response which is resulting in the ALI, ARDS and death, while it is the more regulated one which finally results in a protective immunity and host survival. So this is what is the main target of IVIG, to reduce the amplitude of the inflammatory response and to give a protective immunity which lasts. Now, the IVIG can act in two ways. They can block the macrophage activation and they can improve the immune dysregulation. So there have been multiple case series and small studies. These are the case series which have shown benefit of giving IVIG, and there is this review which looks into most of the studies coming from China. These are mostly case series and retrospective observational studies, most showing some benefit of giving IVIG. Now, this is a randomized trial of 30 patients, and in this they found that the giving IVIG resulted in reduction in mortality rates. And a similar study of high dose IVIG, in this they found again a reduction in mortality after giving IVIG. This was again a very small study in only 26 patients. So if you look closely, there have not been much studies, mostly case series, case reports and just small studies. In the context, the actual role is not to boost the immune system, but through the immunomodulatory effect, it is to suppress the hyper immune response that is seen in most of the patients, which is actually leading into the worse outcomes. This suggests that the greatest benefit of IVIG is achieved early. However, this should not discourage the use of IVIG in more prolonged courses as well, because we still don't know what could be the effect in the long term, and it may have some benefit, though theoretically it has been shown that it can have some benefit. Now, this highlights the importance of selecting the right patient at the right time, which mostly for as of now is early and in patients with hyperimmune response, which could be a CRP of more than 70 if you are trying to focus it. But if we look for trials, then currently there are 37 studies ongoing with 23 in recruitment phase. None of them have been published as of now. So clear evidence would be visible after some time only. Now there is one more effect of IVIG which is being investigated in COVID-19 is the fact that the COVID-19 causes microclots. It is the inflammatory response in the alveoli which ultimately results in a clot, microclot formations in the microvasculatures. It is these clots which are probably causing the initial hypoxia. Now, in this study, they tried to show the improvement of microcirculation in sepsis in IgM enriched immunoglobulins. In this study, had almost 30% patients who had a pulmonary infection, and in them they found an improvement in the perfusion of small vessels, seen over here. So if we look into the role of IVIG as an adjunct therapy, it has multiple interventions in critically ill patients with severe community acquired pneumonia or COVID pneumonia who are having sepsis. But if we use it in all patients, then most probably we are not going to get benefit because it is going to be a very heterogeneous group and the effect that we are trying to find will not be pronounced, and if at all there is a mortality benefit, it will not be clearly seen. So poorly characterized patient population, if the study is done, the more likelihood that this study is going to fail. So for that, we need more personalized medicine with more investigations and more biomarker driven personalized therapy, resulting in more precision medicine, which may result in more improved outcome. So as far as IVIG is concerned, if you are giving it, it has to be given early in patients who are having a CRP of more than 70, and it is better if we can also document that they have a lower level of immunoglobulins. So it is this population, and in this population, if it is given early, there is a highest likelihood of getting a mortality benefit. Thank you for your patience, and check our website for further information.